Hello, Trilogy members. Welcome back to our keynote speaker series for this month. I am super excited to be back. Several of you may have actually missed me last month. I was out having a little shoulder repair surgery, so I'm back in action. So let's get started. Before we do, I want to remind everybody that we are recording this session. So that if you maybe a spouse or a significant other or you would like to watch it again, we will be posting it on MTL as we always do. But let's kick off today's session and thanks for being here. It is a Wednesday afternoon in Arizona and we are super excited to be hosting once again. Our pleasure to introduce to you registered dietitian, nutritionist, and TV host, Zonya Foco, here to share maximizing your brain, what to eat, to think and feel your best. Many of you may already know her, and you probably tuned into today's session because you thought you could learn another great fun fact or two. So her previous two sessions, we started out kicking off the month of January with anti-aging food secrets. And then in February, Kelsey hosted the program on lower your cholesterol with these three foods. So again, if you missed it, they're out there on MTL for you, and you can replay them at any time. As a reminder today, because we know in both sessions, we've gotten a lot of Q&As. So Kelsey Cooper, who is also on the team here in Central Services for Blue Star, and is also an honorary guest at our MTL Monthly, she's going to be manning the chat and also posting those recipes for you as we get to that part of the program. So hailing from Onsted, Michigan, remember the name rhymes with Zonya, so it's Lasagna, is the host of Zonya's Health Bites, a weekly half-hour program that's aired on public television stations nationwide for over a decade. She's also the author of best-selling cookbooks, Lickety Split Meals and Eat Real Cookbooks. So all of the recipes that she's been sharing with you over the last several months come from one of those two cookbooks. Her six online programs for controlling diabetes, depression, and blood pressure, as well as cholesterol, may be one of those things that if you participate, you might be able to shock your doc at your next appointment. So here we are with Brain Health. Let's get started. Please help me welcome a huge round of applause for Zonya Foco. Turning it over to you, ma'am.
Yay, Sarah. Thank you so much. And welcome everybody, Trilogy members. So excited for you to be here. So welcome to Maximizing Your Brain Health. Wow. How can we like get our brain to be the best it can be? Have any of you like started to wonder about your memory? And sometimes it's like, oh man, sometimes like clouded thinking just isn't quite as, it's like, man, I'm just not as sharp as I used to be. And how can we make a difference? And can we? Does what we eat make a difference? And when it comes to having a stroke, when you think about the brain health and having a stroke, are there foods that can reduce our chance of having a stroke? Why, yes, there are. And Alzheimer's disease, dementia, are there things that we can do? And yes, there are. And that's what today is all about, foods to maximize the brain, from just how we feel, how we think, our memory, just from every day, but also helping to fight those big things. And I think this subject goes really deep for me, really deep. I think it's probably my most concerning subject of everything that I talk about. And it's because of my mom. I want to introduce to you Grace, a super, super aging senior right there. Grace, she's been a regular runner, never overweight, didn't smoke, didn't drink sugary beverages, ate a balanced diet. And look at that. She got 35 minutes. She did a 5K in when she was just 70. And I'm like, oh my gosh, mom. And there she is at 80 years of age, winning first place in her age group. Yep, that's my super aging mom. I mean, talk about amazing. But it was all really very, very good until my mom was turned into her late 70s. You can come back to me. Thank you. When my mom came back in her late 70s, what my mom, like, wow, that's when her memory started to go and when she was diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease and passed away 7 years later. And when you think about, well, that just goes to prove that diet and exercise, you know, you're just going to die of something. It doesn't matter. There's nothing you can do. She already did everything that she could do. But guess what? That's what we thought before. But what we know now, science is really showing so many things that my mom would have done had she known it. Simple things that I'm going to share with you today. 9 different things, simple, that you can do every day, foods you can add that are absolutely known to maximize brain health. Things that my mom would have done had she known. Let's go back to our slides. And my mom, as you take a look at what mom would do, the brain needs the right fuel. All right. Certain foods contain compounds that support your brain health with executive function, memory, mental flexibility, and self-control. And definitely foods do that. And while certain foods absolutely have the compounds that slow blood flow to the brain, we don't need blood flow slowing to the brain. But certain foods absolutely do that. We're going to uncover those today. Increase inflammation in the brain and promote amyloid plaque in the brain. Yep, we know that now. Things that my mom didn't know, but would have absolutely taken advantage of had she known. So the two big concepts, and I talked about this in the anti-aging when we did that in January, and I'm going to talk about it again. Look at this time cover from 20 years ago, talking about the secret killer, inflammation. And here we are 20 years later, and most people aren't doing that much different with their diet. And we can, and we should be. The two big concepts to understand, oxidation and inflammation. So oxidation, if you slice an apple, it starts to turn brown. And that browning is oxidation before your very eyes. And if you put lemon juice, though, on a sliced apple, right? The lemon juice does what? It slows the browning, right? So, wow, that's antioxidants before your very eyes. So the oxidation is the browning. The antioxidant is the vitamin C in the lemon juice. Now, we happen to know that we can measure the liquid of every one of our eyes and measure it for vitamin C level. And people who have a lot of vitamin C in the liquid of their eye get less cataracts, which cataracts are a process of oxidation, right there on the edge of their eyes. And if we have liquid in our eye that has a low level of vitamin C, then you get more cataracts. High, less cataracts. So the moral of the story is to take lemon juice and squirt it in your eye? No. Moral of the story is, how do we get a lot of vitamin C and antioxidants pulsing through our body all the time, every day, breakfast, lunch, dinner? How can we make that happen and get more antioxidants? And antioxidants come in more than just citrus. Yes, citrus every day is a great, fantastic idea. But to be able to also incorporate all the other antioxidants, which are in pretty much every color of the rainbow, from blue, green, red, yellow, all the fruits and vegetables, all those bright colors, and being able to get those antioxidants in a really high amount. And that will give you that high antioxidant level in your blood, which then reduces oxidation on things like cataracts, but pulsing through the whole body from cancer, but also specifically brain health, increasing that blood flow to the brain, decreasing amyloid plaque in the brain. So oxidation and inflammation, both those two things are big pivotal things that we're talking about today, and the foods that we're going to talk about subtracting and the foods that we're going to talk about adding to be able to improve our brain health. So back to our slides, let's take a look. What's our next big concept? I'm going to play a game and I'm going to introduce 9 different foods to you that are really pivotal, important. And the way I'm going to do this is true or false. So I'd like for you to perch over to your yes and no, and go over to the chat. And I want you to put in there, yes or no. What do you think? True or false? Are you ready? So you can put T or F, or yeah, T or F, true or false. Consuming nuts daily has been shown to improve cognitive function by up to 60%. Wow. Look at that. We got some truths. We got some truths and some yeses. All that's all good. And You guys, that's great. Thank you for saying that and having this confidence in me that yes, it is. Absolutely, it is true. In neuroscience right there in 2019, you know, looking at, oh my goodness, for 5 years, we have known that nuts are this amazingly powerful. Improving cognitive function by up to 60%. And nuts, you know, we like to have chips, but can we have nuts instead of chips? Okay, chips are going to be something that increases inflammation in the brain. Nuts are going to be something that decreases it. So when you can do the swap, the one out and the one in, you get a double whammy improvement instead of just adding nuts to whatever it is you're eating, but eating them instead of chips. Why instead of chips? Because of the fat that they fry it in, everything that's going on in that component. It doesn't have the fiber. It doesn't have the magnesium and the chromium, all the trace minerals that are in nuts. Doesn't matter which nut, have variety. You got to have them every day. So you got to have nuts every day. So have a variety. They all lend wonderful things. Walnuts have some omega-3 fatty acids. Almonds are good. Cashews, pecans, all of them. Peanuts, even though they're a legume, but their legumes are good too. So they're all good. So you did good on that first two faults. Are you ready for another one? Then let's do it. Our next true or false has to do with berries. What is it? A study found that women who consume two or more servings of strawberries and blueberries each week delayed memory decline by up to 2.5 years. Well, I'd like to decline memory loss by 2.5 years. I think that sounds just from one food. We're talking about 9 different foods today. You add that to the nuts, we're going to be doing really good. What do you think? Is it true or false? I see the truths lighting up the board. Yay, yay, yay. You guys are good. It is true. And but guess what? It's only true if you eat them several times a week. And we have to really make that happen. Like, and that's, I want to like talk to you. Like, how are you doing? Like, are you doing this several times a week? Like, you buy them frozen or have them fresh or, you know, dried fruits. Let's take a look at how to really make this happen so that we don't miss a beat. And I shoot for every day so that that'll come out to be every other day. And that's how it works for me. I absolutely have them almost every day. And they're so incredibly good. So, and even what's so great is they reduce blood sugar spikes. Berries do because of the fiber content they have. Plus they're sweet, but the sweetness doesn't override the fiber that it has. It actually decreases blood sugar spikes. And that's important. We want to keep blood sugar very much not high and controlled healthfully because that helps our brain as well. Definitely any kind of diabetes definitely decreases our brain health as well. We want blood sugar levels to not be high. It's kind of like sugar in the gas tank of a car, right? When you have sugar in the gas tank of a car, we do not, it's bad for the car, right? And same with managing diabetes. If we have diabetes, we want blood sugar maintained and low. So very, very important. So berries are fantastic food for that department. Smoothies. I love smoothies. My husband is the smoothie king and he'll make smoothies often, so much so. Alrighty. Are you ready for another true false? Are you perched and ready? T or F? True or false? Studies show consuming one serving of leafy greens daily helps slow cognitive decline as well as macular degeneration, heart disease, depression, and cancer. Look at all those truths. Nicely done. I don't see any falses. And you are right. It is true, 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 true. Wow. And so this is one serving of leafy greens. You hear about the blue zones and the people who live to be over 100 years of age, and they're not talking about in a nursing home 100 years of age, but out gardening and doing the stairs and hoeing and like unbelievable things in to be 100 years of age. And these centenarians looking at how they do it. And they have leafy greens every single day. They have legumes every single day. There's a lot of really awesome foods that they have every day. Nuts every day. Berries every day. And my mom didn't have a giant salad or cooked greens every day. She might have had a sandwich. It was always a well, you know, thought out lunch, a sandwich. But at our age, you know, being able to have that bread and trade that bread for some leafy greens is a swap that is good. Now, I'm not anti-bread. I like to have some bread. But ever since I crossed the 5-0 mark, it's one slice instead of two. And it's a big salad to go with that. That small thing can have a big impact on our brain. Also weight control, a lot of really great benefits, helping us control our blood sugar for type 2 diabetes, helping us control cholesterol, a lot of reasons. And as we saw, macular degeneration, reducing our chance of cancer, depression. Oh my goodness, that leafy greens. So I want you to think about a salad more often. In fact, let me show you that in our house, we have four of these and these large salad bowls, these bowls. Now, a lot of people use them to serve mashed potatoes or pasta, but this is a single serving, one for Scott, one for me. And this is salads, like one giant salad a day. We have it at lunch or at dinner, or one of the other big giant salad. We're not talking the small salad, we're talking the big salad. So, and it's always big, dark, leafy greens. And I love buying the tub that's already washed and ready to go. I mean, you know, just go with it. I mean, great stuff. Easy to make salads. So making them happen. So there's salads, but what else? What about turning them into smoothies? Like looking at that beautiful smoothie right there. Look at that nice green smoothie. Doesn't that look good? Like, do you guys make smoothies? Do you make green smoothies? I have a recipe for a green smoothie that's really, really good. It's the glowing green smoothie right here. This was made in a ninja blender. And I would like for you to see how we put this together. And so let's just roll tape. I want to show you. This is on page 161 of the Eat Real Cookbook, if you have that. And this green smoothie right here, we do smoothies three different ways. I'm going to show you this one. Now, it starts with orange juice. Remember, we're going to use a lot of kale in here. And a lot of kale, we're not going to sweeten it with honey or sugar, but we are going to use fruit to sweeten it so that it's very good. So we're going to get a lot of fruit servings, but we're going to get a lot of vegetable servings. Look at all of this. So we've got an apple and orange, and our liquid we're using is orange juice. And look at all this kale that we're putting in here. Kale is an amazing green. It's even better than spinach for a lot of reasons. So I'd encourage you to step on over to kale more often than spinach if you can, because it's just a way better outlet, way better for many reasons. And when you blend this up, now this is a Vitamix. It'll also work great. Vitamix makes it really smooth, as you can tell. It's really nicely smooth, where a Ninja Blender might be a little less smooth, but any of them will work. And this makes two good sized servings that this recipe that I just made. But look at that. I'm putting a little strawberry on it just to make it pretty. But that is, when you drink this, when you taste this, it does not taste green. You could blindfold yourself and you would taste the citrus. You wouldn't think it had all that kale in it. Now, the question is, I happen to know that some of you are sipping some green smoothies right now, I think you might be Cabochon Club on Vertera and Seven Summits Lodge in Washington State. What do you guys got? Can you put it in the comments if you are indeed tasting those, because you're doing watch parties and I believe that you maybe are mixing these up, or maybe you're going to have them later. I'm not sure. Or maybe you're having them already. I don't know. And maybe you did the recipe exactly the same, or maybe you made it a little bit different. I don't know, but would love to see your comments in the chat. So let us know what you thought of it. My experiences, I will tell you the story that I, when my son was about 12 and we had all of his cousins, so our nephews over, so four boys, all in their teens, and it was Sunday morning and I said, what do you guys want? You know, hey, I said, tell you what, how about I make this green smoothie? And I got the recipe from the football team that was going to the Super Bowl that year. Can't tell you how many years ago that was. And it was about 10 years ago. And it was the Super Bowl and it was the nutritionist and she had posted this green smoothie. And I said, hey, let's make this green smoothie. So it was just this recipe, made it. And I said, it really helps the muscles repair and rejuvenate and get going so that they can get back to practice more quickly. It gives their muscles what they need, but it's also great for the mind. So muscles and mind, the whole thing. And so the boys were like, really? Okay. The Super Bowl. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. The team. Yeah. Football. Okay. So I serve up these green smoothies to the four boys and all four of them drink down this green smoothie, and none of them said anything. They didn't say whether they liked it or not or whatever, but they all finished it. And then we went off to church, and then we came back, and I said, so what are you guys hungry for? What do you want? And they said, could you make some more of those green smoothies? I was like, I guess I take that as a compliment. Maybe they liked it. And I said, sure. In fact, you guys can make them. And I got out the ingredients and I let them make them, and they ate. Drank another green smoothie. And so I just think it's really fun. I think it's really fun. So there you go. Now there are so many ways to do a smoothie. Let's go to our slides. I'm going to show you my no fail smoothie formula. One cup of liquid, always put the liquid in the bottom. That'll get the blades moving. So you don't really need a recipe ever. And you can just make anything that you have. But if you just follow this smoothie formula, one cup of liquid, one cup of soft fruit, bananas, berries, peaches, apples. Look at that. I mean, you can put grapes in there, like anything, right? And then one cup of frozen fruit. If you use all frozen fruit, it will be really stiff and you want it to be the perfect straw sipping texture, right? So one cup soft, unfrozen fruit, one cup frozen fruit, and then a veggie. You definitely want a veggie in there for sure. And cauliflower is a great thing to put in a smoothie. No one will ever know it's in there. It has such a neutral flavor. But really any sweet potato, eggplant, you get the idea. Carrots, cucumbers, really anything in there. And then a boost is optional. I didn't put a boost in the other one, but to be able to make it more of a meal, to have maybe some protein, to have some added things, you can add a boost to it. I often add flaxseed or chia seed to the smoothie, absolutely. And then a sweetener, optional sweetener to be able to, I don't ever add the sweetener. I like to use fruit. I let fruit be the sweetener and it's sweet enough, but that's totally optional. Sometimes a date will be helpful, especially if you've got a lot of veg in there. So I always put at least one veg in there, but you can up the veg and down the fruit, however you would like and your taste buds work. But look at that, orange, green, pink, purple, you can make them anything you want. I will tell you this, that if you mix blueberries and kale together, you won't get a pretty color like that. But it's okay. It doesn't always have to be a pretty color. So there you go. You got the idea? You got the idea. All righty. So let's talk about your go-to beverages for just a little bit. Do you drink water first thing in the morning? How much water all day? Hydration for the brain is so critically important. You wake up dehydrated, and we need to absolutely get water down the hatch. We are like a wilted flower when we get up. How do we know? Because when's the best time to weigh yourself? You weigh yourself first thing in the morning and you're pretty light. Well, it's just because you're a little bit dehydrated. You haven't drank anything all for 8 hours. And I know you peed before you got on the scale, right? And you're a little bit dehydrated. It's what we call your dry weight. And then you go and you drink coffee, and coffee dehydrates you. You drink a cup and you pee a cup and a half. It has caffeine in it. It dehydrates you. So you want to hydrate first thing. We want a hydrated brain. You're talk about thinking better and feeling better immediately. Talk about filling in your crow's feet and looking younger immediately. Yes, very important. So I definitely want you to remember that hydration first thing. I make myself this right here every single night. I fill it with ice. It holds all night long. It holds for 24 hours. And I put it in my bathroom so that as soon as I get up, right there it is, I start drinking. So I am hydrating. I'm well hydrated before I come into the kitchen, before I could make tea or coffee. And then it's okay to have tea or coffee, but you want to be hydrated when you drink it. So that's really, really important. And, what are your things? So I want to talk about diet soda a little bit, because if we're talking about brain health, I have to talk about diet soda. The American Heart Association, new research suggests drinking at least one artificially sweetened soda a day greatly increases the risk of stroke and Alzheimer's. Whoa, compared with less than one, diet drink, a week. Yeah, we always think that it's we're getting away with something, right? It's diet soda. It has no calories. We think we're getting away with it. But look at that increased risk of stroke and increased risk of Alzheimer's disease. And I just think that's really important for us to know. And so it's really not something we should rely on. So what are some great choices? When we fill a cooler to go out on the boat, something for friends, this will be what we might do, you know, from tea, unsweetened tea, of course, and just learning to like unsweet tea, do it 50-50 until you get it down to where you like it unsweet. I'm from Michigan. We don't sweeten tea here. And LaCroix, I didn't like it at first, but I like it now. Buble, and then that Zevia, if it's sweetened with stevia, which is really okay. We think that is okay. The other artificial sweeteners, no, or they don't test out well for safety, at least according to the Center for Science and Public Interest. And I think that's a good reference for us. But these would be your great choice beverages. And coffee, good news. Coffee is actually good for the brain. It's high in antioxidants. It improves cognition. So we have a hard time coming up with bad things to think about coffee, other than that we have to have a caffeine cutoff time, a really good caffeine cutoff time, so that you end it. For me, it's 3 o'clock, nothing caffeinated, no iced tea after 3. So definitely do that. You definitely want a caffeine cutoff time for sure. All righty. Next one is green tea. It's loaded with antioxidants and polyphenols and catechins and EGCG. Yeah. These are great things that help us on a lot of things, from a mental, but whole body. And black tea is still good too. Green tea has some additional benefits, but black tea has an amazing amount of antioxidants as well. And herbal tea is really good too. But I have learned to have one green tea a day. Now, you want it to be moderate. If you drink tea all day long and not water, what's going to happen is it will actually decrease your ability to absorb iron. So everything in moderation, right? I definitely have one green tea a day. I probably have a black tea as well. And I have an herbal tea as well. So I have variety. Remember, there's so many great ways to do this. And it's so fun to have these in your refrigerator and dazzle your guests with them, and just to make water taste good, or to use herbal teas like this, that those zinger teas help lower blood pressure. The zinger has hibiscus in it. Yeah, that's what it is. Hibiscus in it. So great choices. So there's a lot of good things. Now, I'm going to have a conversation about alcohol. How much alcohol do you drink? Just want to ask you that. So we're getting hydrated, right? So we've got nuts, we've got berries, we've got greens, and we're hydrating, and we're hydrating properly. And we're going to use caffeine to our benefit, not our detriment. And we're going to have a cease time so that we get our good sleep that we need, our REM sleep. But what about alcohol in itself? Is alcohol good for the brain, or is it not good for the brain? You know, you always think, is some alcohol good, or is no alcohol better? What is best for the brain and for overall health? And, you know, some studies, and we love to talk about the studies that have shown that it's good for heart disease and diabetes, but alcohol has been linked to high blood pressure and stroke and heart disease and 7 types of cancer. Really? And osteoporosis and birth defects, accidents, and violence and suicide. So, but just take in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, those top 5, just take those in. And alcohol is linked to those things, 7 times the cancer. You think, well, that's only if you drink a lot. Well, take a look at brain health. And the American Cancer Society is suggesting no alcohol is better than none, especially if you're a breast cancer survivor, because there's links to even just moderate drinking to breast cancer. But when it comes to the brain, which is what we're talking about today, Dr. Daniel Amen, a really awesome psychiatrist and brain disorder specialist, he says, here's 5 scary ways that alcohol damages the brain. Yeah, according to brain spect imaging. Yeah, it shrinks brain volume. Well, that doesn't sound good. It lowers blood flow to the brain. Causes atrophy of the hippocampus. You want your hippocampus. That's a good thing. You want it. You don't want atrophy, which is shrinking, reduces the number of new brain cells, and increases the risk of dementia. And you can read more here, but I just want you to know that when we're looking at things that my mom did My mom used alcohol daily. It was a big part of her life. And I wonder, like, Mom, had she known what we know now? Had she known that Alzheimer's was in her cards? Had she known, would she have cut back on alcohol? Would she have not thought it was good for her? Because she thought that, you know, well, some alcohol is good. And the revised recommendations for moderation for those of us that would like to enjoy some alcohol sometimes. Well, what's the new moderation? The new moderation, in light of these new studies about brain health and breast cancer and the 7 different types of cancer that it's linked to, used to say for women, 1 a day for 7 days a week, which is where my mom was at. And now it's no more than 2 times a week. And for men, 2 in a day, it was all 4 in a week. You could 7 days in a week, but now just 4, just 2 days in a week. So alcohol, just 2 days a week, 1 drink for women, 2 for men. And it's like, huh, everybody has their own choices. You get to decide. You get to decide how you feel about this. All right. It's really up to you. Doesn't mean you have to give up all the good connection time with friends. Have you tried sparkling water mocktails? You know, they have really awesome zero alcohol beers now. I mean, you can have some good times. You don't have to give that up. Healthy Pop is my, we serve club soda, like a LaCroix with a splash of juice on top and a wedge of lime. And we serve that. That is like my go-to non-alcoholic beverage. And you serve it in a nice stemmed glass and you're having a good time. So alcohol sometimes, you know, there's a lot of times when we can step away from alcohol, and it helps us with weight control too. I always say, do I want to drink my calories or eat my calories? And I always would rather eat my calories, but it's really up to you. But I really did want to mention that moderation and let you think about it, and you get to decide. But this is what we know about brain health. So pretty important stuff. All right. Are you ready for another true false question? You guys ready? Are you perched and ready? True or false? Tell me what you think. True or false? True or false? Eating 3/4 cup of mushrooms twice weekly reduces, and these are cooked mushrooms, so 3/4 cup cooked mushrooms twice weekly reduces the risk of cognitive decline by 25%. 25%. Wow. So we see some truths. We see one false. Who's the person that said false? Jim?
Yep.
I wonder what Jim's thinking, because Jim might be right. You guys, it's not 25%. What are you talking about? The answer is, it's definitely false. The answer is, it's 50%. I tricked you. Jim, were you with me? Were you like, yeah, it's more? Was that what you were thinking? It was more? Yeah, that's what you were thinking. And are you kidding me that they found that eating mushrooms, what is it about mushrooms? They are really amazing. And you know what? That's not all. Eating mushrooms plus green tea decreased breast cancer risk by 64%. Wow, 64%. So mushrooms are pretty amazing food. And this is another thing that my mom, she would have ate mushrooms twice a week if she knew that it helped her brain, but she didn't. I remember the day when I bought mushrooms every time a recipe called for it, which was about 4 times a year. Now, my husband and I reach in and buy at the grocery store 2 containers of mushrooms every week. And we don't need a recipe. You just chop it and add it to every stir fry, to every spaghetti sauce with vegetables and stuff. You add mushrooms cooked, and you do want to have them cooked versus raw. And the reason why is that there's actually a toxin in mushrooms that is a negative. It's an anti-nutrient. Not really a toxin, but it's an anti-nutrient that is totally taken away when you cook it. So it's not that an occasional raw mushroom on a salad is going to hurt you. I wish they would send a memo to all the salad bar restaurants and they wouldn't have raw mushrooms on the salad bar. But in general, cooked mushrooms are much better. And a quick cook in the microwave or on the skillet in the oven, roasting them, it's easy to do. So whenever we roast vegetables, mushrooms go with. Whenever we saute onions and peppers, mushrooms go with. Mushrooms, anytime you have a ground beef, chop up your mushrooms, grind them up, and put them in with the ground beef. No one will know that there's mushrooms in there, especially picky people who don't think they like mushrooms. My son is one of them. He swears he won't eat mushrooms, but he eats them all the time and he doesn't know it because they're chopped up fine and put in there. And we have a little mini, a little blender that will buzz them up and you put them in and they don't know it's there. So let's go back to our mushrooms a little bit. It's time to retry them, right? Like a lot of times you're like, I don't like mushrooms. They're slimy. They go, I don't know. First of all, grind them and hide them, like I talked about. And add them to soups and stir fry. Just add them to any, you don't have to have a recipe. And then roast them and stuff them. Oh, there's a recipe in our free recipe spot that's totally good. You totally would love to make those. Add them to soups, add them to eat them in, you know, a nice big portobello instead of a burger. They're fantastic as a burger, but always eat them cooked. That definitely is, if you're going to be eating them this consistently and this often, then you definitely want them to be cooked. Sound good? Yeah, you definitely want them to be cooked. Very good. All righty. We're kind of going like the speed of light and we're doing good on time because I want to be done by 2:45 so we can do the question and answers. If you have questions, you can put them in the chat or actually there's a Q&A section. If you put them in the Q&A section, they'll be more organized. And Sarah and Kelsey are organizing those for me and they'll we'll get to them during our last 15 minutes. So hold tight. Any questions, put them in there. All righty. Which do you eat more of? I want to ask you this. Do you eat beef, chicken, pork, or fish? What do you eat the most of? Chicken, beef, pork, fish? Do you eat fish and then chicken? Which do you eat most of those four things? Well, we got, I got some fish. I got some beef. I got some chickens. I got chicken and fish. Very good. I like chicken and fish. Fish. There's quite a few fish answers. You guys are so healthy. Oh my goodness. You should teach this session. Turkey, then chicken. Okay, good. Yeah. At poultry. I should have called it poultry. Really chicken and put them together. Nice answers, you guys. Chicken. I like this order. Chicken, fish, beef, pork. Okay. That's an interesting order to put it. Chicken, fish, beef, pork, and that in that order. Okay. I like the order of that. Okay, great. You got where I'm going. And nice job, you guys. Nice job. I'd love to eat more fish, but a lot of the more endangered. Yeah, you're right. You know, really trying to do safety, you know, what is renewable, all that good stuff. Good point. Well, I do want to share with you about omega-3 fatty acids and how important those are for our health. Omega-3s and fish is a key place. It's beneficial. Omega-3 fatty acids have been linked to lowering blood levels of beta amyloid, the protein that forms damaging clumps in the brains of people with Alzheimer's disease. And in America and in my mom's diet, she did not have, we have a lot of omega-6 and not very much omega-3. And when you're able to reduce the amount of beef, pork, chicken, and increase fish and increase fish, then you're going to be able to get more omega-3 and less of the omega-6. And that's going to help decrease this amyloid plaque. Yeah, really important. So protects against cognitive decline, dementia, Alzheimer's disease. Yeah, that's what we want to do, help prevent depression. Oh my gosh, this is really big for people fighting depression. It's really important. Cancer and eye disease, recommended 2 to 5 servings per week. So yeah, two to five servings per week. Well, there's tuna at lunch. Remember, there's 14 lunches and dinners in a week. So maybe 2 to 5 out of those 14, you could probably do it. Maybe you could. I want you to know in America, the average fish consumption is only once every 11 days. Like, oh my gosh, once every 11 days, we really need to step that up and we need to learn how to cook it. And you're right, sourcing it, wild fish, that kind of thing. Also want to mention, we want to avoid mercury contaminants for sure. And it's pretty easy to avoid Mercury from sharks, swordfish, tilefish, king mackerel. You know, if you did have swordfish like occasionally at a restaurant, that would be fine, but certainly not on a regular basis. And then also limit albacore tuna, not more than once a month. Ah, and light tuna, not more than twice a week. I know a lot of keto dieters that are bodybuilders that are, they're pounding the tuna, cans of tuna, and they eat the whole tuna, which is like two servings, and the whole can, and it's like not good to do that. So that's really important. So I want you to know that this is important stuff. And So unfortunately, Mercury is getting into those foods. But what do you want to choose? Your top choices are salmon and trout. Trout, don't overlook trout. It's a fantastic choice. Herring and sardines. My dad and I, he's a wonderful 79-year-old. I wish I had a picture of him and I enjoying splitting a tin of sardines for lunch and just really enjoying those together and a fun little father-daughter bonding moment. And did I say 79? No, he's 89. 89. He's in great health, but he has had some mini strokes. And that has affected his brain health as well. And so between my mom's Alzheimer's disease and my dad's mini strokes in his brain, this is, all this information runs hard. But I think sardines are one good thing that my dad does, that's for sure. So there are some ideas for you. I do want to show you how to make these fish tacos with simple slaw and avocado. When I share the slides with you, those are links to the recipe, but we're also giving you the links to the recipes. So don't worry. We actually gave them to you ahead of time, but they'll be posted again for you. So they'll be available to you. But I'm going to show you how to make these fish tacos. And you can, I call them fish tacos with simple slaw and avocado cream. The avocado cream is over the top, makes it amazing. We're making these super simple, easy. Those were our ingredients right there. We're going to preheat our oven to 400 degrees, and we are going to use this little mini chopper, and we're going to make the avocado cream first, which uses some Greek yogurt in it, first of all, and then some lime juice. Yes, indeed. And then some garlic, some good fresh garlic. I just want to get the paper off. I'm going to let it do the rest of the blending the rest of the time. And then avocados and jalapeno. Yes, if you remove all the seeds, it will not be hot, but it'll have a nice fresh jalapeno flavor. And add some seeds if you like the heat. And avocado, look at that, nice and fresh. Take the pit out just like that. And scrape, 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 scrape. You want to get all of that dark green that you can. Don't want to leave any behind. And definitely want to get all of that. So just a little bit of salt. This is a quarter teaspoon. You could omit the salt if you wanted to. It's still quite low, even with that little bit of salt. But pepper. So we have lime juice, salt, pepper, avocados, and Greek yogurt, and the jalapeno. This makes an amazing, amazing avocado cream. So now we're going to serve this with asparagus and mushrooms. That's what pairs really nicely with this recipe. So there's our, and they don't have to be special mushrooms. They don't have to be. They can just be your white mushrooms or they can be portobello mushrooms. There are some benefit to some of the other lion's mane and all the other mushrooms out there. But you know what? The benefit really, the studies are done on just your plain normal mushrooms. So you saw that we have olive oil, salt and pepper, very simple seasonings here. And we're just going to roast these up 400 degrees. And then we're going to mix together chili powder, cumin, garlic powder, and pepper. We've got these mixed together. Recipe has our amounts. I'm just making a serving for two for Scott and I. And wow, this is some really wonderful wild Alaskan cod that I am using. And it's great with salmon though. Salmon is wonderful as well. I've been subscribing and having it shipped to me, really fresh wild Alaskan salmon and cod. And, but you could use tilapia. You could use, lots of different fish for this. All right. I'm cheating and using this coleslaw mix. Yeah. Because you only want to chop so much and some fresh cilantro in there. Definitely worth it. Rice wine vinegar. We've got a tablespoon of that, just a tablespoon of some olive oil in there. And then we're just mixing that up. And going to be able to add, you could add a bit of salt to it if you wanted to. Don't have to. I think I omitted that. So we're just going to put our corn tortillas and get them a little bit of a toast going on. And our fish is done, ladies and gentlemen. As you go, you give it a twist and it's, that's perfect. That's flaking perfectly. It's done. It's ready. You could roast those longer if you wanted them more crispy, but I think they're perfect. They look just perfect for me. So Nelson just got and I for dinner this night. So we're going to do 2 tacos each, and my son would have 3. And we are, look at that amazing cod. Again, salmon is great for this too. But then to be able to just fill that baby up with some coleslaw and add in some wonderful, that avocado cream on top, squeeze on some nice lime juice as an extra wonderful punch to this. And I'm going to serve this with our asparagus and our mushrooms and some grapes to really bring this meal home. And oh, just stuff some mushrooms right in there. Oh, I'd stuff quite a few more in there. That, ladies and gentlemen, is a wonderful fish taco. I'd love for you to try it. Would love for you to try it. So I've showed you some smoothies and I've showed you the fish tacos and just roasting vegetables. I mean, roasting vegetables, one of the things is learning to roast vegetables 2-3 times weekly instead of a couple times a year is how I used to do it. That'll give you some ideas. All right, I'm going to go back to my slides to make sure I finish and land this plane. Let's land this plane, shall we? Will you make the fish tacos? I hope so. That's your homework assignment. Did you know you get homework in these presentations? Yeah, I give you homework to do. So we'll get back to our slides and we'll land this plan of what you can do to bring this home. So you're going to make the smoothies. And let's see, we backed up a little bit. Here we go. We'll just go forward a little bit. No problem. Somehow we got ahead of ourselves. That's okay. Here we go. And oh, if you don't eat fish, get your omega-3s from plants. You can do that. You absolutely can. So give that a try. I do know somebody, she was like, oh, I just don't like fish. But when she tried trout, that made all the difference. So you can try different things. But these are great plant sources of omega-3s. So definitely do that. So bringing this in, land in the plane, foods that hurt the brain and foods that help the brain. Take a look. Sugary drinks, diet drinks too, water first thing in the AM, plus black coffee and green tea. Black tea and herbal tea are excellent too. So you got that? Foods that hurt the brain, foods that help the brain. Alcohol, sparkling water mocktails, no alcohol, or only 2 to 4 servings per week. So 2 for females, 4 for males. And desserts, cakes, cookies, pastries, ice cream. Sugars are so bad for the brain. I talked at length about that in our anti-aging in January to really talk about how sugars are very pro-oxidants and how they are pro-aging, but they're also very bad for the brain, and how we can use blueberries and oranges and all fruits. They make the perfect dessert. So what a great swap out. And then fried foods. There's, you know, acrylamide. I could have talked about so many things that are occurring when French fries are deep fried, when foods are deep fried, and they aren't the good for you fats that they fried in. Avocados are really good for you. Nuts are so good for you every single day. Seeds, olive oil, avocado oil, those are your best choices. When we make that swap out, that is absolutely giving our brain what it needs. You know, few vegetables and small salads. No, 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 no. Let's go for large bowls of dark leafy greens and mushrooms, at least 3/4 a cup, right? Twice a week. And all veggies are really great for you. And then fatty meats and processed meats, thinking beef, pork, chicken, fish. I'd love for you to change that up and love for it to be fish, poultry, and lean meats. Definitely love to make that be the thing. And then fish high in mercury, we want to avoid those. And we want to absolutely choose fatty fish that are clean and lean and good for us. So there you go. That kind of lands our plan for you, ladies and gentlemen. I just want to remind you, if you enjoyed today and you missed either of these, check MTL for the past webinars and you'll find them. And that leads us to Q&A. I'm only a few minutes over. Yay. Sarah, take it away. What do you guys have?
Well, first of all, another great presentation. So thank you so much. And then I've got Kelsey here beside me. So we're going to do a little share of the screen. as we talk through some Q&A, and we had some really great questions again, which we always expect to have.
Yay!
Did. Okay, so we have some that kind of relate to the specific recipes and then also some about just general ingredients, Zonya.
Yep.
Okay. So I think I'm going to start with the general ingredients first. So first question was specifically around strawberries, but how important is it to eat organic versus normal produce?
Yeah, great question. You know, we're looking at Parkinson's disease, which is also a brain disease. And one of the A number and key components is to avoid certain pesticides, chemicals that they use and are avoided when you buy organic. So that is a key. I do think buying organic as much as possible. I do not like to spend money unless it's necessary. Like, I don't want to have tricked written across my forehead. But in the last 10 years, the studies have been really compelling that there is true benefit to organic. Now, you can look at the Dirty Dozen list, that the foods that are most likely to still have pesticides, you know, remaining on them, and strawberries are one of them, that they're very hard to rinse off, they're porous nature, and it's hard. So I always look for organic strawberries, and buying them frozen is really the best way. And then whenever I'm buying fresh strawberries, I don't always find organic fresh strawberries. So I tend to buy more frozen than I do fresh for that reason. But I'm also going to tell you that I'm not possessed, because people have less cancer the more produce they eat, not more cancer the more produce they eat.
Mm-hmm.
So if you can't, I don't know, I can't eat that because it wasn't organic. No, eat it, because there's over 100 compounds that fight cancer. And maybe there's a trace, you know, something. But in general, if your budget can afford it and it's available, I always go to the grocery store. I always look for all the, oh, that's organic, and that's organic. Oh, and that's organic. And I, you know, and then I'm like, okay, I got what I got. And then I buy the rest of the stuff. So I do what I can. I'm reducing it by the percent. And strawberries are one on the Dirty Dozen list. It is one that would be nice if it was organic when you can.
Okay.
Next question.
Kind of on a similar note, are there any other vegetables, or I guess even produce, that you would suggest avoiding to eat raw? You sort of mentioned it with the mushrooms, but someone specifically said something about the lectin in green beans, or is there anything else kind of along those same lines?
Well, definitely no raw legumes like kidney beans or pinto beans. You know, those need to be cooked and properly cooked, which they are. Typically you buy canned beans and they're properly pressure cooked and the lectins are gone. I know that there's a lot of people on the internet talking about lectins being bad for you and legumes, but no, they're cooked and therefore there are no legumes, no lectins. And the longest lived people of the earth eat legumes every single day. Cooked, mind you. So some people think that having cabbage, anything from the cabbage family, might be slightly more better cooked. I have some raw, some cooked. I don't limit it to only cooked. That would be terribly boring in my world, but there may be some benefits to cooked over raw. Carrots, you'll actually get more nutrition out of cooked carrots than you will out of raw carrots, because we can bioavailable because of the cooking does that for us. So the pros and cons both ways for fresh and raw or uncooked. But I think that mushrooms are the biggest thing that needs to be cooked. I'm not thinking of anything else that's like, you got to have it cooked. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Well, moving back to the world of fish. So I'm going to do this as a two-part question because I think it goes together. So one, what are your feelings on farmed fish versus wild-caught fish? And where do you source? Someone specifically asked about your wild Alaskan salmon, but how can you help our members source, you know, great quality wild-caught fish?
Yeah. So I live in Michigan. I am not going to find good fish, you know, wild Alaskan fish. So I do, I subscribe to that subscription, wild Alaskan fish, wild Alaskan seafood, wild Alaskan, what's the brand? And every 2 months I get a shipment of their fish. In fact, yeah, one of the labels, Scott's getting it out. Aha. So it does. Wild Alaskan Company. Now this is halibut right here, but grab a salmon that's in there. I know we had salmon two nights ago. And this one doesn't have a label on it. The label, is it in there? Because they fall off in the freezer sometimes. But halibut, salmon, sockeye salmon, and they also ship me rockfish, which is a really delightful fish as well. But it's Wild Alaskan Company. So for me to have it shipped, dry ice, the price, I'm looking at the price going, it's cheaper than a restaurant. You know, you order this kind of thing in a restaurant. It's cheaper than that. Is it more expensive per pound than I could buy at the restaurant or at the grocery store? Yeah, it is more expensive than that. The shipping is free, which I appreciate, but it's not really free because you're paying for it. But the cost, when I look at the cost and I'm like, this is fresh caught wild Alaskan, frozen, packaged, freeze, you know, and shipped to me. And I'm like, hey, that's as good as it can get where I live.
Absolutely.
And if you live in Arizona or Washington State or maybe Washington State, you can get fish a little bit. Well, you're a little bit closer to Alaska there, but anyway, I hope that helps. That's what I'm doing to source it. Ask your fishmonger, get to know them. I think wild is way better than farmed. However, there are a lot of people that are like, well, I can't get wild and I don't want to eat farmed, so I'm going to eat chicken instead. And you may be better off having farmed salmon than chicken. And you're like, did she just say what she just said? Because of the benefit of the omega-3 fatty acids that chicken is not giving you. Do I think it should be wild? It's kind of like the produce. You want to eat the strawberry, whether it's organic or not. Is it even better organic? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's even better organic. And I think it's kind of the same thing on the, some places are farming well. I think Faroe Islands is doing, from what it's all marketing, right? But they're doing a pretty darn good job doing some really oceanic farming. And so it's not small pens and, it's big fish nets in the ocean, big ocean areas in the Faroe Islands. So I think you can find some sources of good farmed salmon, but I'm going with wild Alaskan. They're my company right now.
True.
I don't even make money on that, but I should. That's right.
All right. Last question on fish specifically is your thoughts on sushi.
Oh, great. I think, sushi is all about how fresh it is and all of that. And I think sushi is a fantastic treat and they know how to do it. I'm pretty much scared of it myself, but I'm not a sushi fan myself, but a lot of people are. I don't really have an opinion left or right that way. So, if you have a lot of confidence in how it is prepared and handled, then I think that's great.
Okay. Great. All right. Switching gears into our mushroom questions. This one's also kind of a two-parter based on two different questions. So are all types of mushrooms good? And are there any mushrooms that give a better benefit than others?
Great question. There's a lot about lion's mane and turkey tail and all these exotic mushrooms that they're breeding them to have even more medicinal properties to them. Mm-hmm. And they may very well be. They may very well be. In fact, I have been enjoying, my husband and I have been enjoying mushroom coffee. Mm-hmm. And this is a particular brand, Rise. There's also Mud Water. There's also Daily Dose. And they are, you're getting in this, it doesn't really taste like coffee, but it is it has a tiny bit of coffee, a little bit of caffeine, but it has cordyceps and reishi and lion's mane and shiitake and turkey tail and king trumpet. And it is, I don't enjoy it black. You just take a scoop of it, hot water, dissolves, and you're getting a significant serving of each of these granulated mushrooms. But the studies that I showed you on dementia used white button mushrooms. And they say you don't have to spend the money on the fancy schmancy mushrooms. That you can just buy your good old white mushroom, like we don't have to. However, there are, you know, some emerging data that's saying there's some benefits to these. Maybe it's mostly marketing, but it's hard to tell for sure. But I kind of like this. And this has taken away my husband's GERD because he was having some reflux, you know, from the acid and coffee. So I don't make money on that either, but it's just a preference that I like. Rise mushroom coffee, we like it a lot. I add a little bit of soy milk to organic soy milk. It has to be, that's one that I'm very strict about being organic. That I add to cream it just a little bit. And I add a little bit of stevia, and I used to add maple syrup to it, and the calories were too much. And I use the stevia right here. It's four drops of stevia. Stevia comes in powder too. I just find this really easy, 4 drops, and it's just a little bit sweet and it's just perfect. And so that's kind of my morning treat after I hydrate. Remember, I hydrate in the bath before I even get to the kitchen. I'm a flower that's fully, you know,
There we go. Okay, kind of moving into the smoothie category now. So for the veggies in the smoothie, we have someone asking whether or not veggies specifically should be cooked first, or if you can put any raw veggies into your smoothies. I know leafy greens are kind of the raw ones, but she asked specifically about cauliflower and sweet potato.
Yes, I think the sweet potato should be cooked. I think it should be cooked. And I do cook the sweet potato before I put it in there. But why do I think that? I think that. I guess I don't have any reason why I think that, but I do. And then cauliflower, we do raw all the time. Okay. And because you don't naturally eat raw sweet potato.
Yeah.
Is kind of why. But you eat raw cauliflower. So there's my answer. Yeah. I would cook that. And I would probably cook the eggplant too. Actually, I've never put eggplant in a smoothie. Have you, Scott?
No,
we haven't done that. Yeah, we always roast our eggplant. It always goes into something else. Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. All right. So a substitution question for your specific recipe that you shared is whether or not there are any substitutions for the orange, both the whole orange and the orange juice in the smoothie. I think that question came in before you showed your little chart of all the different things you could add. But with that recipe specifically, would you recommend something else besides the orange?
Yes. So if the person can't have the orange, I have to say the citrus is a nice balance to all of that. Now, it could be you've got the apple in there, and that may be enough to sweeten it for a lot of people. And if you wanted to just use a cup of water, you have a banana in there that's also sweetening it. So, and you wanted to go a cup of water and the banana, the apple, and leave it at that, then that would be good. Okay. And if it wasn't sweet enough for you, then I would use apple juice. You know, at least apple juice is, I mean, you know, it doesn't have the fiber in it, but at least it's not sugar. It is naturally derived from fruit juice. So it's better than adding, well, honey is a medicinal food in itself, but sweetening things with honey and stuff, I really do like to use fruit and fruit juice and that nature, but either apple juice or just water.
Okay. Sounds good there. A couple of other ones on just kind of your thoughts about things, it seems like. So I think this was kind of in the time when we were talking about the chicken and the beef and how you should kind of eat those in relation to one another. But someone was asking about meat substitutes like Impossible Burgers, tempeh, or soy curls. What are your thoughts there?
Great question. Thank you for asking. Tempeh, number one, fermented food, organic. Always buy every soy product you buy organic. And it's because they use glyphosate on soy. And glyphosate, if there's ever one to avoid, it's that one. And so that's why I'm very strict about corn and soy being organic. So I buy frozen corn as well. And if I'm going to buy a corn tortilla chip, an organic corn tortilla chip.
Okay.
But being able to have, I think the tempeh, it's fermented. We need to have more fermented foods, and it's fantastic. I'm so impressed with tempeh. And I use tofu. I just used tofu the other day in the crock pot for my Asian. All right. So some of you, I think, have the Eat Real cookbook. There's also the Lickety Split Meals cookbook. This one is the easiest recipes, common everyday ingredients. There's no pictures though. And so this is more of a basic cook person or a Monday through Friday or just easy meals, but this is taking it to the next level with all these great things and then color picture with, you know, with every recipe. But I was talking about, oh, I made the Asian chicken, but I used crumbled tofu in the crock pot for the Asian chicken. It turned out fantastic. Scott and I said, I think we'd have it that way every time, like, and trade out the chicken for tofu. Advanced, I thank you for asking this. Now, soy curls, love that product too. A dried soy curl product that you rehydrate and you can use it like meat and like so many things. Oh my goodness, super excited about that. I did check on the product and they said they were GMO free and they don't use heavy pesticides, but they weren't organic. So when I looked at the company, I was like, I think it's Butler soy curls. And I was like, well, it looks pretty good. But they weren't organic. And I have a strict line on soy for organic. So I just wanted to mention that they might be in transition getting to organic and sometimes takes a while to get to that certification and expense, but it looks like a dang good product. I haven't purchased them myself, but I've had them out and I'm like, oh my gosh, these things are amazing. So tofu, I buy it organic. I'm getting very regular with tofu. So many things you can just swap it out for. And it just, it has, nobody can say tofu tastes bad. It just has no flavor at all. You just have to double the spices because it'll, you know, just soak them right up and just really be heavy handed with it. And crumbling it is kind of like crumbled meat, you know, cubing it. Sometimes people get all weirded out by cubes because nothing is normally cubed like that. But you can roast the cubes and, you know, using low sodium soy sauce or coconut aminos. Coconut aminos are very low in sodium and a really nice soy sauce replacement. For keeping sodium down. So yes, I think those are great things. Hey, that's an idea for another session.
Mm-hmm. There we go.
Because we have just finished like our series of three. So I would love to talk more about tofu and all the ways and the reasons and the benefits and how we have a dependency on meat and how we need to decrease our dependency on meat and more plants. Mm-hmm. We need to get our protein from plants. Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. Okay. I think I have just one more question. I know there's some other ones, but I think the last one that a lot of people are going to want to hear the answer to is, you know, how do you determine what one serving is of some of these foods? Like we talked about a lot in the true or false, the nuts, the berries, the leafy greens. So do you have just like a quick guide of what kind of one serving looks like for each of those?
Thank you. It's an excellent question. Wow. Great question. So leafy greens are kind of big and you pack them down and, you know, you cook them. So it's like a half a cup cooked and a cup raw is a standard guideline for those for a single serving, but that's like minimum serving, right? You want to have that or more. And then with nuts, I guess it's really a half ounce to an ounce. So it's what you can hold in one hand we can eat handfuls, not just handful. So it's really kind of a handful. So it's not really a lot of nuts. Because we start adding nuts every single day and you're eating four or five handfuls every single day, you're probably going to like pack on some pounds that you don't want to do. And remember, it's instead of things, but really it's just a handful. And I know for myself, I have to like, it's easy for me to have nuts three times a day. And I'm like, okay, like I got to not overdo this. Right. So great questions. The nuts, the berries, it's right at, it's like a half to three quarter cup of berries. I like to say a fistful of fruits and veggies, like a fistful. And my husband's fist, hold up your, he, you know what? His is bigger than mine. And you know what?
We're going with Scott's fist.
Yeah.
Yeah. I like to go with his fist and stuff, but children have smaller fists, you know, so their serving is a little bit smaller. And I think the fist is kind of a really cool guide for a lot of things. But those are great questions. And then like meat on a plate, like if it's a quarter of the plate, which a lot of times it's half the plate, right? It should meat really should only be a quarter of the plate. And then veggies should be half the plate. Well, when does that happen? But it can happen, you know, so it's changing up things in the balance is definitely a great way to go.
All right. Well, I know there were a couple of questions we didn't get to, but I know we're already late over time. So Thank you everyone for tuning in. I'll let Sarah and Zonya do the official sign off, but thanks for letting me be your question master.
I love it.
Kelsey, you're a good question master. Thank you so much, Kelsey.
Yeah. So again, we want to thank you so much for the last three programs. They have really been inspirational for our members. And one of the things that we were talking about before we got started today was maybe switching the day and the time of when we've been doing these might be an indicator of attendance, or it could also be the content and how relative it is to our aging demographic and how we want to live longer, healthier, happier lives. So our partnership has been very, very important to us. And I'm sure that we'll be having you back again in the future. And thanks to your AV guy too. Appreciate you guys so much.
Yay. Sarah, thank you so much for planning these, putting everything into it. I had a great time. Thanks for inviting me. And Scott, we both thank you so much. And to all of you Trilogy members, keep being awesome. Keep being always learning, always moving, being awesome, living your best life. Really proud of you all. So thank you so much. Thank you, Sarah.
Bye now.
All right. Bye, everybody.